To the rest of you who live in Thyatira, I say, as many as do not have this doctrine, who have not known the depths of Satan, as they say. So now the Lord addresses all those Christians in Thyatira who did not accept the polluted teachings of the woman Jezebel. All of you who do not know those things that they claim to know, the so-called deep things of wisdom, which are nothing but the deep secrets of Satan. Under the name Jezebel, my friends, we must also include another category of faithful, who, much like the illumined of last week's lesson, they stay in the church, they attend church, receive Holy Communion. However, their activities, as far as the faith goes, are totally irreconcilable with the teachings of the church. Let's not forget that the woman Jezebel in the epistle of the Lord to the Bishop of Thyatira is of a Gnostic background, because in this epistle the Lord says she teaches and deceives my servants to commit fornication and eat food sacrificed to idols. Consequently, Jezebel has a Gnostic background. Remember when we dealt with the Nicolaitans, who were also of Gnostic influence. The important thing here is that the so-called false knowledge, or the things falsely called knowledge, as the fathers described, the ancient church fathers and Saint Irenaeus, this knowledge is labeled by Christ satanic. And the Lord now addresses all those who are closely connected with the bishop, and they have stayed true to the healthy teachings, and they were not indoctrinated, as the heretics would claim, in deeper knowledge and wisdom, and in reality, demonic knowledge and demonic wisdom, satanic. These heretics were speaking about the depths of their wisdom was an exclusive wisdom, secretive knowledge, and an approachable and untouchable wisdom to the infidels, to the unsacred and uninitiated. And since the secret work of lawlessness is constantly at work, according to St. Paul, even today, especially today, in our days, an offspring of Gnosticism is Freemasonry or simply Masonry. Masonry is a Gnostic heresy. Surely enough, the books of the Masons call all of us, the non-Masons, defiled or unsacred. They claim to have the light, the illumination, and the initiation of the depth of knowledge, the depth of wisdom, the depth of philosophy, which we are ignorant of, as they claim. Therefore, Freemasonry is no less than a natural descendant of ancient Gnosticism. It can be classified as neo-Gnosticism, if you will. I may have referred to Masonry so many times, and I may be at risk of being labeled as somewhat of an anti-Masonic psychotic. My friends, this is not the case. Masonry is a contemporary reality which affects everyone and everything in our times. And it is certainly not a good strategy to underestimate the capabilities of the enemy. In order to successfully fight an enemy, we cannot underestimate his power. And Masonry is powerful. It is the power of Satan. And this is precisely why we're always fighting, and we'll always be fighting, continue to fight, as long as we live against Freemasonry. Do not be misled by the fact that it has no public life, no publications, no lectures, no recruiting agendas, no open advertising. It works secretly. Masonry is Gnosticism, and this is precisely what we will try to show today with God's help. We will prove that Masonry is of a Gnostic dimension. We will see this by using the official documents of Masonry, their own documents, which we happen to have in our possession. Once we prove this, then their doctrine will be included in this very letter of the Lord to the bishop of Thyatira, who condemns the woman Jezebel. Jezebel is the perpetrator of this foreign doctrine, which comes to deceive and mislead the servants of Christ. And since Christ condemns her, it only stands to reason that he also condemns Masonry. We need to prove this, and I must ask you, my friends, to give me your undivided attention to see and learn how the Masons themselves define their philosophy. We will do this directly and not indirectly. Even though it is more than obvious, I repeat, Masonry is Gnosticism, and once we show this, then the case is closed. Was Gnosticism? It is under the condemnation of the church once and for all, because Holy Scripture has written against Gnosticism. St. Paul to Timothy and Peter in his Catholic epistles, they both write against Gnosticism. It is not surprising that the church fathers fought Gnosticism with an unparalleled vengeance, because it fought the church with the same vengeance. But because Gnosticism may not be familiar to all of our listeners, I will simply say a couple things about it, even though I have done so a number of times in the past. In just a few words, we could say this. In reality, Gnosticism happens to be a religious philosophy. It accepts a God, a world, and a human being. It accepts certain relations between God, the world, and men. It looks at the world with a double vision, as good and evil. So it sees good and evil in the world, and it states that good in the world must be the work of the good God, and what is evil in the world must be the work of the evil God. Consequently, God is not one, but two, or two persons. God consists of two personalities, or simply two gods. Please keep in mind that there are great variations within Gnostic philosophy, great variations, great differences between the Gnosticism of Marcion and Gnosticism of Vasiliades, and many others, and they all have their own idiosyncrasies. But all of these different Gnostic systems maintain the basic foundation of dualism, the existence of two gods, the good God and the evil God, the good God who creates good and the evil God who creates evil. They're always in war against one another, and in the midst of this battle, man is always the unfortunate victim. Man is forever struggling to become free from the evil God. In the final analysis, Gnostics believe that man always hopes for such a deliverance. He lives within nature. In a way, he does not believe in an omnipresent God, even though he considers God invisible, but in reality, not above time or space. And Gnosticism strives to borrow many elements from outside, because Gnosticism in itself is an empty and naked philosophy. It does not have anything by its own merit. So it takes from whatever every human philosophy has to offer, and whatever the mystical religions have to offer. Orphism, Eleusinian mysteries, Hermetism, the thrice grand Hermes, the Easter mysteries, Cybele, the mysteries of Osiris and Isis. These are ancient Egyptian mysteries. It has used elements from all these. It has taken elements from Judaism and from Christianity. Gnosticism has made a philosophical mixture of all these, and it offers this as its own. The danger behind Gnosticism is that it does not deny Christianity officially. And here's the danger. Now, if someone tells me, "I don't agree with you, I deny your beliefs, you are my enemy," I understand this, and I keep my distance. However, when you hide and you don't show any denial, you move about, you exist, breathe and slither inside the church. You take Holy Communion, you attend church, but you are an enemy and estranged from the body. And here's the danger, as we will plainly see this in the Freemasons. They take Holy Communion, they may be on a parish council, they're always in church, and they will use this to their advantage. If someone would question them, they respond, yes, I'm a Mason, but I'm also a good Christian. I come to church, I take Holy Communion, I love my brothers. This is not to their advantage, but to their detriment. It is most unfortunate. This is the predicament of the woman Jezebel, who moved freely inside the church of Thyatira, and she happens to be the typology of the contemporary Gnostics and Masons, as she was for the ancient Gnostics as well. But as I promised, we will begin to expose some of their documents and their own literature, and we will notice that inside their lodges and in their booklets, a central position is reserved for the letter G, which is often placed inside a star. In the Greek lodges, the third letter of the Greek alphabet is used, the letter gamma. In the Latin languages, the letter G is used, which can be placed in the center of a star, or it can be inside this very common figure, which you often see on the welcoming signs of every city and every small town, a blue sign, and in the center of the sign, they use the letter G, enclosed by the configuration of a square, and on top of the square, like the square of the tool of the builders, and on top of this 90-degree angle tool, they place a protractor open at about a 45-degree angle, and this is the most popular sign of the Masons in this country. You see it on the rings of bankers, maybe, some of your attorneys, and on the lapels of judges, and also on the temples of Freemasonry as you drive around. Now, the square and the protractor are not as commonplace as we think. The symbolism around this figure is very rich and multi-sided. I will only tell you some of the most basic symbolisms, I think. The square on the bottom with a right angle is the symbol of matter. And on top, the protractor, opened at a 45-degree angle, symbolizes the spirit. So this symbolism pertains to spirit over matter. Dualism. How can the spirit subdue matter? Keep in mind, my friends, that Christianity does not accept two godly sources. There are not two gods. God made the heavens and the earth, and the things of the earth. There's nothing that has not been created by the one God. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. The Word of God created everything. So it is not possible to have contradictions in the words of God. How is it possible to have good and evil work against or go against these very objects or creations of God? If evil exists in the world, this is not a consequence of dualism. It is the consequence of the interference and interaction of free-willed logical beings, the devil being the first. This explains the introduction of evil. And after this free-willed decision to rebel against God, the harmony of nature was shaken. This is how our faith explains evil. And not that it is some creation of an evil God or the one God in a state of contradiction or disharmony between spirit and matter. So there's really no such disharmony, because the infinite spirit, God the eternal spirit, creates the material world. How could this material world then be in opposition to the existence of God? Why would God